Oh, it's you, Dweller. Am I late on another video again? I'm sorry, but I just haven't been happy enough to make a video. I hope you're not mad at me.
I see. Well, I've seemed to notice that you've been hurting as of late. Is there a way for you to stop being sad?
You just don't get it. I appreciate your concern. It means a lot to me that you care that much about my well-being, but my emotions are not something that you could just turn off.
I was gonna make a joke about how I can, but look, while I may not understand normal emotions, I do miss the enthusiasm we had when working, and this year has been lonely, so please, as my friend, I would like you to make a video not for me or anyone else, but for you.
Okay. I'll do it. Because you're my friend. Wait. I think that just gave me an idea of what I'm ready to talk about. Let's get out of here. And be sure to tell the fans that Redstar's back. Hello everyone, I'm back. Just to clear things up, I have been gone for a year, but only from video making. I'm still very much Basement Dweller's editor. Recently, I have had a breakup, but the full story also involves college and other things of why I was unable to return for so long. For anyone worrying about my well-being based on the beginning, the beginning was just a dramatization of what happened. I don't want to elaborate any further, just know I'm in much better spirits, and I just wish to reintroduce myself to video making again. So, let's get started. For my return movie review, I would like to review One Piece Movie 6, Baron Omatsuri and the Secret Island. The reason being is that I empathize with the message and themes of the film, being loneliness, trust, and friendship, which in all honesty is everything I had to deal with. But before we get into this, I feel that I must know, while I am a fan of One Piece, my knowledge is very limited since I am still on earlier arcs of the series. But I didn't want my knowledge or lack of knowledge to get in the way of reviewing a movie that I deeply enjoy. So, let's literally and figuratively get into this episode, because I will be experimenting with a new format. Don't be afraid to leave your opinions. Alright, first off, before talking about the movie, I would like to point out that this movie was directed by Mamoru Hosoda, and it is very evident by the change in art style, which I feel is a welcome addition to the film, and just makes the characters, in my opinion, much more expressive. Now that I got that out of the way, the movie opens up and the Straw Hats are invited to Omatsuri Island, where luxuries beyond their wildest dreams are promised. I apologize for that joke. It is here where we meet Baron Omatsuri, who offers the crew a challenge known as the Trials of Hell, in exchange for the treatment that they were promised. The opening challenge consists of the crew needing to catch a giant goldfish against the Baron's right-hand man, Muchigoro. During this trial is where we see the Straw Hats at their best, as they complete the challenge with relative ease, as we see the dynamic between the Straw Hats at play. including this cute little moment that emphasizes the whole friendship theme by having Luffy dive into the ocean to save Chopper, despite the fact that they are both physically unable to swim.
Oops!
Now, with the first trial being done, I would like to take time to discuss the Baron. At first, he seems like your typical trickster character that has a trick up his sleeve to make sure his team has the upper hand. He also has this weird little flower on his shoulder, which is very much alive and even emotes throughout the film. Kinda weird, but not a reason to distress him. But we also notice his crew has sprouts growing out of their heads, which is also kinda weird, but all will be answered. This is just some food for thought before being slapped in the face with a captivating conclusion. Fast forward into the second trial. The second trial splits the crew into two teams of two, consisting of Usopp and Nami, Sanji and Zoro. But this is where the crew's trust in each other is definitely put to the test. Because during a ring capture game where each team member has to apprehend the opposing team, cracks begin to form. Sanji and Zoro begin to argue, but this time it emphasizes and holds on certain looks that they give each other, which turns a typical running gag into a moment that sits with you and makes you worry for everyone's well-being. Same goes for Usopp and Nami. Due to a misunderstanding that makes Nami believe Usopp left her to fend for herself, and with Usopp deeply offended by the accusation, he brings up past events and labels Nami as a backstabbing specialist, which turns them against each other. As we see what it would take to destroy that bond, all of this unbeknownst to Luffy, Chopper, and Robin, who all have their own mini stories that all intersect by ending with more knowledge about the Baron and his island. Okay, so let's take this piece by piece, first starting with Luffy. And if you're wondering, the movie loops these events in as the other Straw Hats are doing the challenge. But just so that I'm not tripping over every little detail, I feel this will just be a whole lot easier. Luffy is led away from Chopper and Robin by this strange man who resembles Charlie Chaplin. He is the captain known as Brief of the Toothbrush Mustache Pirates, and he leads Luffy, albeit with a very funny chase scene, away from the others to give us our first direct warning of the Baron, stating that he destroys friendships. Robin is left with Muchigoro, who lets us know of the presence of the Lily Carnation. Chopper has the most ominous and captivating event following his exposition, where he willingly walks away from the group and meets with a very skittish man only referred to as Papa by his children, who also account for his crewmates. Papa is a very cowardly man but promises if Chopper helps him with his facade of bravery that he displays to his children, he'll tell him more about the Baron. As soon as Chopper obliges, the next scene with Chopper, we are shown a bounty poster, only something isn't right. The Baron is significantly younger, while the crew looks the same. Not only that, but everyone sprouts missing from the photo. Right before we are able to let this information sit, the Baron strikes Chopper down with an arrow, incapacitating him. This is where we near the final act, and the most disturbing parts of the film. We are left with Chopper being taken, cracks amongst the crew beginning to form, and the warning Luffy was left with by Brief slowly becoming a reality. Luffy and the crew, unknowing of Chopper's fate, continue at the resort, where we see the group begin to split up, unconcerned with each other's well-being, as evident by Nami wanting to steer clear away from Usopp. Usopp is then left alone, and that is when he is subsequently taken away by the Baron's DJ, DJ Kappa. All while Sanji is in a competition with the Baron's chef, Zoro's resting, and Nami turning her attention to Muchigoro. This is when we are given the backstory of the Red Arrow Pirates and how amazing they were, even rivaling Gold D. Roger. Uchigoro emphasizes they saw him the other day, despite Nami explaining Gold D. Roger has been dead for 20 years. Uchigoro in disbelief states they did see him before the storm. It is then when Uchigoro begins to wither away, knowing of his true fate, and now us as the audience, we know that everyone on the island is only a reanimated corpse of the Baron's design, with no memories leading past the day they perished. While this is happening, Robin is taken by the Baron after learning of the Lily Carnation that sits atop the mountain located in the center of the island. And it is here where we see the disgusting worm-like demon that makes the Lily Carnation, with the flower on the Baron's shoulder acting as a second body. We cut back to what's left of the crew as they argue amongst each other, with an underlying tone of fear and concern dawning upon them. Sanji exclaims that this was all Luffy's idea, so he is at fault, as a look of shock washes over his face as the weight of his crew being taken away sets in. Now we are given a very grim scenario because Luffy has always been able to protect his crew physically from anything that opposed them, but the Baron systematically formed cracks through the crew's emotions, creating distrust amongst themselves, which led to their separation, and it was all underneath Luffy's nose. Luffy, realizing his failure to keep his crew safe and his greatest nightmare coming to life, demands the Baron return his friends as he prepares to do battle. The Baron obliges, but overpowers Luffy with seemingly endless supplies of homing exploding arrows. Luffy is then saved and pulled underground, but the crew, left separate from each other, as they hide from the shooters chasing after them, led by DJ Kappa, who attacks with exploding plates. Right when he has the upper hand on Zoro, Zoro sees an opening and attacks, but this only momentarily confuses the DJ as he is presumably unharmed. That is when the Baron takes the opportunity during Zoro's confusion to deal a sneak attack, rendering Zoro unconscious. Then we have a chilling interaction between the Baron and his DJ, where DJ Kappa seemingly comes to the same conclusion as Uchigoro, but is comforted by the Baron gaslighting him into believing it was his strength that kept him alive. This gives us a direct insight of what this illusion means to the Baron, and how far gone he has let this illusion consume him. We are then shown that Luffy was saved by Brief. It is here where Brief shows him his secret base and how he's been able to hide from the Baron for so long. Luffy notices a photo of Brief's crew. Brief explains that it's just him now. He's all alone. And his crew was captured by the Baron when they were eaten by a giant monster. As we are putting things together, we then cut to Chopper as he wakes up, being prepared to be fed to the Lily Carnation. As the flower attempts to eat the youngest of Papa's children, Daisy, Chopper springs it into action and bravely fights, only to be eaten in exchange for Daisy, to where she tries to save Chopper in return, but is then forced to cower away by her father, who won't risk his life or the lives of his children to save him. As Chopper is about to be swallowed, he is greeted with the rest of the crew waiting to be digested, one by one. He is then sucked in and about to meet the same fate, as the plant slowly digests each member of the Straw Hats. We see the Baron's crew regain life, and we see how for 20 years, the Baron was able to keep this illusion. which makes this situation even more chilling. Luffy then finds an escape and challenges the Baron head on, but is met with an arrow launched through his hand, pinning him to a rock. This is the most heartbreaking scene, as we see one by one each crew member sink into the flower, and one by one each of Luffy's hands and feet are shot with an arrow, and the feeling of helplessness is overwhelming as we see Luffy resorting to launching his head, but only to have his efforts in vain as his head plummets back to the rock beneath his last crew member, Zoro, his first crew member to join, and the first person to give Luffy his trust, disappears. Luffy is then put into an almost catatonic state, not wanting to accept that he failed and is now truly alone in this world. The Baron gives him a choice: loneliness or death, exclaiming most men in his situation have chosen death. Luffy refuses to answer, being paralyzed by grief. The Baron then takes aim as we see the flower on his shoulder chewing, eating the digesting members of Luffy's crew. As the Baron is about to deliver the finishing blow, Brief saves him, but with the help of Daisy, telling Luffy that she can hear his crew members calling to him from inside the flower, Luffy is then filled with hope and believes he still has one more chance. That is when Luffy is given his straw hat by Brief and salutes him, providing him aid with the tunnels. Luffy, filled with more determination to save his crew, emerges from a cloud of dust, not being fooled by the Baron, and dodging every arrow effortlessly as he makes a mad dash to the flower. As Brief pokes his head from the flower, the Baron sets sight on him. Luffy, not willing to let any of his friends die, protects Brief and nails the Baron in the face, leaving him unconscious. He then declares Brief as his friend as he gives the toothbrush mustache pirate salute. Without wasting any more time, Luffy destroys the flower, only for there to be a problem. They were not in there, and their cries are coming from somewhere else. It is then the Baron emerges, as we then know where those cries were really coming from. The Lily Carnation then mutates into a fleshy abomination with a spine-chilling laugh to go along. As the blood-red moon illuminates the now broken stem of the Lily Carnation, we see it morph into arrows, all being pointed at Luffy. And Luffy's fear and shock detailed through his expressions say it all. Every single arrow is then launched at once, impaling Luffy, as the Baron states that every arrow signifies each day he was left alone. Luffy, with dozens of arrows all pierced through his back, still doesn't quit fighting as the sounds cut out and we hear Luffy crawling as each arrow embedded in his back rattles and scrapes across other arrows. This is definitely Luffy at his most helpless. But as all hope seems to be lost, Papa, having a conversation with his daughter, Daisy, questioning if she can really hear the straw hats, to where she says she knew her father was lying the whole time, but didn't care. Because even if he doesn't believe himself to be brave, she always believed in him. Is where Papa picks up the Baron's bow, and even though overcome with vast amounts of fear, he summons enough courage to kill the Lily Carnation, ending the illusion. all of the Baron's arrows and crew disappear, and it is now the Baron who is truly alone. At this point, the Baron weeps, holding the remains of the lily carnation. The Baron, turning his sights to Papa and Brief, begins plodding towards them. But out of nowhere, Luffy punches the Baron as we fade to black, where we learned that this final attack that Luffy dealt killed the Baron. As we hear him weep and then comforted by his crewmates that he lost, as they apologize for leaving him alone for so long, he is then told that he should have moved on, found friends just like Luffy. The Baron is now put to rest and reunited with his friends. The Baron is a deeply tragic character who is unable to let go and move on from his traumatic loss, to where he had to make this illusion for himself to live, to play pretend, just to have one more day with the people he held dearly. But in turn, he became bitter, knowingly destroying friendships and killing just to have that one more day. Loneliness and being alone can make us bitter, bitter at the world. When we are alone, we only think of ourselves, to ourselves, and think how we could have been better, constantly living in moments where we went wrong. But if we can just let go and move forward, we can find our Luffy, someone who will fight tooth and nail to see that we aren't left in this world alone. I'm sorry, I went on a bit of a tangent, but in the end, Luffy wakes up to see his crew, has no recollection of what happened, and with a big grin on his face, the movie ends. This is one of my favorite anime films, and I hope I got some new people to enjoy it. I'm looking forward to talking about other movies or media. I'm truly grateful that I had Dweller by my side. And like I stated in the beginning, I resonated with this film because I felt alone and constantly wanted to relive in moments where I thought I was at my happiest. But then I realized being with the people who still care for me, like Dweller, that's where I'm at my happiest. Thank you all, and have a groovy day. I've been Redstar, and that's it.